Welcome. Welcome. Bonjour. And greetings from Geneva. Yesterday I was walking by Lake Geneva with my daughter. There's a nice fun fair there on the shore, and groups of friends and families from one every corner of the earth were just wandering through and enjoying it. And I was reflecting back to the founding of Caux just along at the other end of the lake 75 years ago, and also reflecting on the founding of the League of Nations here in Geneva. And feeling a sense of tremendous gratitude and encouragement from the vision to create those. Well, we have three very distinguished panelists with us today. Each has been to Caux in person. I think Luke has been on innumerable occasions, and all have distinctive vantage points on international affairs. The philosopher Gabriel Marcel said of Caux that it's a place where the intimate meets the global. And in our preparatory calls, I asked each panelist if they'd be happy to put aside their institutional hats and share more intimately some gems, as Antje put it, of their own insights and encouragement for us. I'm happy to share that they were all very willing to do that. So I'll just give a brief round of introductions to each panelist before we start. Luke NGOs is the founder and president of the think tank GPS Dev, Governance and Policies for Sustainable Development. Before that, he was the executive secretary of the UN Convention to Combat Desertification. And in that capacity, he conceived the concept of land degradation neutrality, which is referenced in UN Sustainable Development Goal number 15. Before that, Luke served as Minister of Environment, Housing and Urban Development in Benin. And he's actually the visionary behind the Caux Dialogues on Environment and Security. So I think we could say that we wouldn't actually be here today if it wasn't for Luke's vision. Dr. Antje HERRBERG is a senior mediation advisor at the European External Action Service of the European Union. She is a co-founder of the European Forum for International Mediation and Dialogue. Antje was a process design expert for the mediation standby team of the United Nations. And she was the chief facilitation advisor to the Aceh follow-up peace process for Nobel Peace Laureate Martti Ahtisaari. She has just returned home from Addis Ababa Tigray negotiations just a few days ago. We were a bit concerned because she has a bout of malaria, but typically she did not shirk her commitment to join us today. Thank you so much, Antje. Steve KILLELEA is the founder and the executive chairman of the Institute of Economics and Peace. The Institute produces the Global Peace Index, the Global Terrorism Index, and the Ecological Threat Register. Steve is an accomplished entrepreneur, having built two major international software companies. He then decided to dedicate his resources of time and money to sustainable development and to peace. Welcome, Steve. So with that round of introductions, I'll just share that the way we're going to do this is to hear key insights and experiences for about 5 minutes from each panelist. And then we'll have a round of further questions, drawing out common strands. And then we'll have a full 30 minutes to respond to your Q&A with the panelists. Please put your, make sure that your name is in the question so that we can cite who you are. My colleague Karina, who's woken up in Washington, D.C. very early today, will be working with me so we can capture the questions as best you can. But fire in questions into the Q&A as soon as they come to you. So with that, Luke, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Alan, and thank you for such a kind introduction. And good morning to you all. I'm pleased to join Steve and Antje on this panel. And to start with the first point you have asked us to address, which is about insight and individual experience of translating theoretical understanding of what creates peace and or environmental restoration into practical action, I personally think that the new normal we must build to address our critical global issues, that new normal calls for a paradigm shift in the way we define sustainable development. And so the question for me is, are we really ready to build the new normal we need? Because that new normal will demand more than building back better, because building back better will not suffice. In fact, you can't better what is intrinsically flawed. We have observed here and there, that nature has thriven when our economic system have been shut down in response to the COVID-19 pandemic. But there are two critical and overarching issues that challenge livelihood and peace, and that we must all face at all levels: climate change and biodiversity loss, to name them. Those crises, they are already there, but unfortunately, we still consider them as looming and have not been addressing them effectively as we should. But these crises, these two crises, are intertwined and have a lot in common with COVID-19 that we are nowadays used to and have been, grappling with. Let me maybe make reference to a few of those characteristics they have in common. One is those crises are systemic. Second is that they are multiplier and amplifiers of existing risk. Another one is that they are regressive because they disproportionately affect the most vulnerable, especially in the developing countries. They have also been scientifically predicted and quite well documented, so it's not for us a kind of black swan. And the cost of crisis management are vastly greater than the costs incurred by action to prevent and build resilience. And finally, the last characteristic they have in common is that they stem from the tragedy of the common, from individual behavior and interest that lead to the depletion of common life-supporting resources. But the major difference they have with COVID-19 is what Mark Carney, former governor of Bank of England, has labeled as the tragedy of the horizon in his famous speech titled Breaking the Tragedy of the Horizon, Climate Change and Financial Stability, and where he stated that when climate change becomes a defining issue for financial stability, it may already be too late, unquote. Wow. Now, remember, in 1987, the Brundtland Report defined sustainable development as, and I quote, development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs, unquote. 30 years later, and despite the global commitment to sustainable development enshrined in first the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goal, and nowadays the Sustainable Development Goal, we seem to be locked into a consumer-driven development model of frenzied exploitation of natural resources beyond the capacity of nature's limits and planetary boundaries. I have long struggled to find inspiration in a definition of sustainable development that is centered just and only around human needs. There is something I believe that is fundamentally disempowering in this framing, as it tends to favor a view of people, especially the world poor, as nothing more than beings with physiological needs, disregarding their humanity, their esteem, their potential. In my work with African and global youth and entrepreneurs, I am often struck by the enormous wealth of intellect, innovation, social consciousness, and motivation wealth that we so often fail to reap in investing in building the future we want for this generation and the generation to come. How can we think about sustainable development such that our quest unlocks this incredible potential, empowers people as agents of change, and respects nature's wealth and limits? As we prepare for the 50th anniversary of the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment in 2022, I do think that it is time for us to rethink how we define and act about sustainable development, a definition and a way to act that will connect our need and potential to that of nature, which we also belong to. Are we ready to build a new normal that will address humanity's global critical issues? I think to some extent we can be, because the very fact that the youth movements are showing leadership and global in addressing global critical issues is a reason for me, at least, to be hopeful that we can succeed in humanizing humanity. Over to you, Alan.
Thank you so much, Luke. I'll hold back on some questions that are coming and pass over to Dr. Antje HERRBERG to share her thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alan, and thank you so much, Luke, as well, and congratulations to thank you to Luke for making us be here in a way, because you have been such a driving force behind this dialogue, and congratulations also to Caux for the 75th anniversary, which is very special. And it is almost sad today that we are meeting, or it seems sad that we're meeting in this virtual environment, where, you know, the real sort of special thing about Caux is, I think, about really being able to spend time with each other in a physical space. So, you know, well done to you for at least pulling together us together in a virtual space. And maybe also to start off those 5 minutes that you asked of us, maybe with less of an institutional speech, I just wanted to share, you know, what got me to Caux. And it is really a coincidence, because it was Patrick Worms who invited me to come on. And to be honest, I was quite a bit reticent about it, because it was a lot of time to be spent away. It wasn't, you know, going to deliver any hardcore policy changes or proposals or of some sorts. But still, I let myself in and trust that process. And I must say, I've never regretted that, because it has had a really life-changing, at least professionally life-changing, sort of effects on me. And namely, the fact that, really how environment and peace really go hand in hand together. I think this is going to occupy all peacemakers for at least, you know, I think from, at least for me, for the rest of my life, because it is so central. In this sense, you know, it will occupy at least my professional life, or I think many of us as well, so much, because it is also such a challenging sort of issue to work on, because it's not only about connecting the small areas of peace and environment, but it is about really creating, a new ecosystem of peace and security that is centered around environment, an environmental upgrade in a sense, or environmental degradation, you know, the way we call it usually. So what brought me, you know, into Caux, and you know, and what I've learned from Caux, I would like to continue to share as well with the world. And in a way, you know, when we were sitting there overlooking the lake and meeting people from all different walks of life, coming from different places, but also working in different fields of action, is something that is exactly what we need to translate in our policy domains in land, lives, and peace. Namely, you know, I learned that it's in, you know, working on environmental issues and peace mediation is not going to make much of a difference in the end, but it is about bringing in environment into the overall field of conflict prevention, early warning, but connecting it also to the fields of food insecurity, demographics, migration, agriculture, and even around the whole question of religion and gender-based violence. So these are all, you know, questions that have occupied us, and I've been able to bring that into my system, the, you know, which is a multilateral system called of the European Union, which has made quite considerable commitments since. We have had four very big council conclusions on environmental issues. We have the Global Green Deal, the way we call it. We have now dedicated 30% of the overall funding that goes into development, which is out of 79 or almost 80 billion euros on environmental degradation. So even the way of how the European Union is going to integrate this into its foreign policy approaches is going to change things. Unfortunately, things don't change overnight, but and they will change in a sort of in a maybe too slow way. But you know, now the challenge for the European Union, in particular, or for multilateral and international actors, is to be able to embrace and to go beyond the different silos of action that we have. For example, it's neither development nor foreign policy nor security, and not, but really bring them together in a horizontal way and creating these connections much more strongly, which is a huge challenge because we have a very specific structure and static way of working. Even within the UN system, we have different institutions responsible for different issues, including the environment. And I think we're all realizing that all of this needs to maybe, you know, maybe not to use, you know, a very peace-friendly word, maybe explode, and we need to sort of reform in a new way. But we can discuss maybe how we should do that. Maybe the most important thing that I wanted to share with you, like today, and I think I said that right at the beginning, is that the real challenge at the moment I see is that rather than squeezing environment into, you know, our existing paradigms, meaning, or even our existing paradigm on security and peace, I think what we need to come up with, and this will be, I think, and a big piece of homework for the international community, but at all levels to come up with, is to really create, you know, a new peace and security paradigm that is an ecological security system. That is something that will have to be addressed not only by policymakers, but also by different communities that are usually part of the security debate. And I hope that this will be a way of working also for this particular group. Alan, if I hand this over back to you, is okay now?
Mm. Thank you so much, Antje, for that sharing. Steve, over to you in Sydney.
Oh. Thank you, Alan. Now, Alan asked me to talk a little bit about my background and journey to peace and what I've found along the way. So my background's in business, he mentioned earlier. I set up two international IT companies. One ended up publicly listed on NASDAQ. the other on the Australian Stock Exchange. So I made a lot of money out of that. And I set up a family foundation aimed at working with the poorest of the poor. And since its inception now, we've done about 220 projects around the world, direct beneficiaries, about 3.6 million people. But working with the poorest of the poor, I ended up in a lot of war zones or near post-war zones. Funded a lot of projects dealing with kids, like the rehabilitation of child soldiers in the northern Ugandas, just one. And then I was in northeast Kivu in the Congo, walking through there, which is probably one of the more violent places in the world. And I started to think, what are the most peaceful nations in the world? And what can I learn from them to bring back into the projects I was doing? But it's a little bit of a fantasy question, really, and sort of just these fantasy questions we all have. Got back to Sydney, searched the internet, and couldn't find a list of the nations of the world according to their peacefulness. And that's how the Global Peace Index was born. But that raises a very simple and very profound question. So the simple businessman, like myself, would be walking through Africa and wonder, what are the most peaceful nations in the world? And it hasn't been measured. Then how much do we actually know about peace? If you can't measure something, can you truly understand it? If you don't measure it, how do you even know whether your actions are helping you or hindering you in achieving your goals? You simply don't. So that was just the beginning. And originally I was just going to produce an index, put it into a university somewhere and fund it. But I started to realise that the whole concept of peace was really profound. We really didn't know much about peace. So most of the time when we think we're studying peace, we're actually studying conflict. And it's, I guess, it's a bit of an analogy like health. Great breakthroughs in pathology. Most of us aren't going to die of heart attacks young. We're curing cancers. But it wasn't until we studied healthy people, we knew what we needed to stay healthy. Right exercise, good mental disposition, healthy diet. You're not going to learn any of those things through studying someone on their deathbed. Same for peace. So that was the concept then of understanding what were the positive aspects of peace. One of the things we found along the way, which I thought was really, really very profound, is just the economic value of peace. So in 2020, the calculations we've got, the cost of violence to the global economy was nearly $15 trillion. That's 11.6% of global GDP. The actual figure's higher because we can only count what we can count. So we look at that again. We look at all the overseas developmental aid in 2020. It's about 1% of the cost of violence to the global economy. Now, no one can imagine a world which is totally peaceful. I can't. But within my imagination, I'm sure within yours, you can imagine a world which is 10% more peaceful. That's the equivalent of adding the economies of three countries to the world, the size of Switzerland, Ireland, and Denmark. And so that is really a lot. But what we found then is what we took the Global Peace Index, and then we took it, and now we've got about 50,000 different data sets, indexes, attitudinal surveys. What we did then was we statistically calculated the factors which most closely associated with peace. And that's called positive peace. We then turned that around and put it into an index. We used statistical techniques to do it all the way. So that way it didn't come up with our personal ideas of what was peace. And so what we found then when we turned that around and put it in an index, we could now look at the factors which create the peaceful societies. And we have the ability now to be able to determine the velocity of different countries. Were they moving in a virtuous cycle towards becoming more peaceful or away? But what was more profound when we took the Global Peace Index and now compared it to a whole lot of other things we thought were important, the same factors which created peace created a whole lot of other things we think are important. So examples of that would be things like higher per capita income. In fact, countries which are increasing in positive peace compared to countries deteriorating have three times higher GDP growth rate per annum. Measures of well-being and happiness, better performance on measures of ecology and sustainability, better measures of inclusion. And so therefore, in many ways, positive peace can describe an optimal environment for human potential to flourish. And so the work we do, we've combined it with systems thinking. So we look at the major challenges facing humanity today, they're global in nature, climate change, ever-decreasing biodiversity, full use of fresh water on the planet. And all these things are global in nature, and they're also systems. But unless we have a world which is basically peaceful, we'll never get the levels of trust, cooperation, or inclusiveness to solve these problems. Therefore, in many ways, peace is a prerequisite for the survival of society as we know it in the 21st century. But if we look at the way we operate our societies today, we operate them along a process of cause and effect, really springs out of empiricism, which has been great. But we need new ways of thinking. We need to be able to view societies as systems so they can fit into these bigger systems which we all depend on. And that is transformationally different. So in many ways, positive peace combined with the concept of systems, a transformational way of thinking about how we regenerate our societies to meet the sustainability challenges of the 21st century. Back to you, Alan.
Wow, thank you so much. Just to pick up immediately there on this question of positive peace, systems, and transformational change. Antje, you were calling for an explosion. Do you see that this kind of systems approach is starting to have an impact, is starting to change? When you speak of an explosion, do you detect the signs of do you hear the possibility that it's going to go off? And if it does, what can replace it?
So that's it's an interesting question, Alan. And Steve, also congratulations to really having developed this work, which is, we are a very good user of it. I mean, we're using this also to identify, now you have upgraded it to also have environmental indicators in this system, which is extremely useful. Now we are animals of linear thinking in our institutions, especially bureaucrats like that. And therefore, in that sense, this type of analysis gives us a lot of, let's say, security, and it has developed a very good, maybe not entirely conclusive, but a very good sort of impetus and reasoning for actually engaging in policy action. So it allows us to do an evidence-based approach. But then, Alan, just to challenge this, I think there still needs to be an explosion. And the explosion needs to be maybe across that we can weave all of this work in a very sort of a holistic way, even though, of course, scientists are quite scared of the word when a word holistic, meaning that, it needs to maybe even have much broader application to the very micro local communities, as well to the global geopolitical system. And this is sometimes where we are still not having the connections. And this is where we need to maybe bring things new together and reform them together. That means that the way of how we're going to make environmental peacemaking is exactly not going to maybe, follow the only, way of thinking that we can think of is namely vertical and horizontal, but maybe there are ways of working. I mean, I don't know whether I have the fifth or fourth dimension, but there is a diagonal way as well, right? So it is really a way of sort of, that's the one thing. And the other thing is maybe just to address this on the explosion is about reframing things, is that when we think about insecurity, or environmental insecurity, maybe can we reframe scarcity as an opportunity as well? When we reframe scarcity as an opportunity, as Luke says, for example, development, this creates a very powerful incentive for parties, conflict parties, but even though, and also, you know, maybe those who are not conflict parties to be involved and contribute to that. For example, I'm giving you the Nile Basin as an example. You know, it's not only about three countries who are in dispute about water sharing or water allocation, but it is all the riparian states that are along, for example, the Nile Basin. This is just as a starter. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Just continuing on this strand, Luke, as the former head of a UN agency tasked with combating desertification some years ago now, how do you see the international institutions that we have adapting to the challenges and the tasks before us?
Well, thank you and congratulations to Antje and Steve for their contribution. It is so enlightening. You know, institutions, especially international institutions and global institutions, they are ill-equipped to work at local level or to work through bottom-up approaches. But the transformation we need will happen if we manage to unlock the capacity, the potential of the people who are actually the custodian of the environment or the nature we all depend on. Remember when I invited Yakuba Sawadogo to Caux. Yakuba Sawadogo is that now quite old farmer from Burkina Faso who has been nicknamed in a documentary, BBC documentary, as the man who stopped the desert. And when he came, he shared what has led him not to to flee from his hometown during the very severe drought of the 70s, but to rather look for alternative way of managing his land. And he has been successful by bringing forth what has been nowadays labeled as farmer managed natural regeneration. That capacity, that ability, that potential, I have seen it here and there all over the world. So I believe that institutions, not only international institutions, even national institutions are ill-equipped to work, you know, by bringing people, capacitating people, trusting them, enlightening them, and giving them the opportunity to precisely do what they know to do, and also trust their local knowledge. So all that are things that we need to learn to do differently. And so, yes, Antje, I really heard, like your explosion concept, and I hope it will happen. Because as I said, building back better will not be enough. Because what I don't like in that motto is to build back. What we have is not that good. It is intrinsically flawed. We need to explode it. I mean, peacefully explode it in a way that will lead us to build the thing we need for a new normal. Over to you, Alan.
Thank you so much. Well, Steve, both Antje and Luke have been speaking of, you know, crisis prevention, early warning. You yourself have said the huge costs and effort that can be put into the actual crisis rather than the positive piece. With the indices that you've helped to create and put out there, and how interesting that, Antje, you find them useful and they're being used. And Steve, do you find that they're actually impinging on this paradigm that we'll start to work at the prevention more now that we can kind of see better what's happening?
I think there's a whole myriad of things which are happening, which are causing people to rethink. So if I went back 20 years ago in business, no one thought about the environment. Today, I'd say most top businessmen really aware of sustainability and want to see a sustainable planet. Concepts of conscious capitalism, that's really moving into the fore and will only gather momentum over the next decade. But if we're coming back, we're looking at change. What we need is systemic change. It's unlikely to come from the top down, coming some other way. When I pick up on some of the stuff Luke said, like the FMNR techniques, like we're messing around with them in Africa at the moment, they were originally invented by a guy from World Vision, and he picked up a number of meetings with him over the years. And these kind of things happen on the ground in Africa. This guy was out there, he'd been working on regeneration techniques for about 7 years and had given up because none of them were working. He just happened to get a flat one day and he looked down to change the flat and there was this little twig growing out of the road. And so he dug out around it and found there was a whole root system. So the FMNR systems are based around the regeneration of trees. It takes trees which might have taken 60 years to grow back in 4 or 5 years. You let them naturally regenerate. So countries like Niger, for example, it's got one of the highest population growth in the world. But it's still, in 2019, I think it was the only country which increased its foliage and coverage. So for me, one of the lessons of my life is we really need to think micro, and this picks up on what Luke said. Too often the World Bank, the UN, and many other agencies, they come in and think macro. They also come in with a set of what they see as the ideal morals and values, which they need to now instill in the programs they're bringing in. But what's really needed is empower the locals to be able to do projects, many of them small in nature, but on a large scale. And look, the other thing too is I see nothing out of the developmental agencies which try and look at how you can actually create businesses which can actually create sustainable environments. It comes into the form of aid. And the aid's very, very good. There's no one who thinks from business. And just simple things like sand dams, for example, cost $25,000 to $50,000 to create. Last, when built properly, 50, 100 years. Water's fresh and you can pump the water out and then you can create agriculture around it. Now you're creating a business, rehabilitating the environment, but where it's done these days, it's done as aid, okay? How do you work out how the locals can actually now create a business around this? So you've got some entrepreneur down there which puts up the capital, the locals, to be able to do this. Might, let's say, get 10, 20% of the crop which is produced for the next decade, 15 years, something like that. But sort of we don't think that way. We come back to systems. One of the really important things with systems, all systems are on a path dependency, a bit like Leo Tolstoy's concept of the march of history. You can't change it or turn it back. And so what you need to do is understand culture and the path it's moving on. And then if you want to change it, you need a massive number of small nudges in the right direction. And the locals are the ones who are best able to understand that. So out of, let's say, the Charitable Foundation, which is a private foundation, we've had some great results where we've empowered the locals to do the thinking on what they want. So we took a bunch of the people who are producing pineapples in Uganda, for example, and what they wanted to do was create something to add value on top of the pineapples. So we loaned them the money to do it, and they created a canning factory, and then they started to can pineapples, created some pineapple wine, and the next minute they paid it back. Now they want to do another approach, then it's another cooperative out of the same area, want to do a similar sort of thing. We used the money from that to do that. They paid it back, and there was another group, and the one we're into now is tomatoes. That's just one example. But we need to sort of get away from our Western lenses and our Western values and let the locals decide what their values are and what they need to do. So we really do need to empower the people, but it's got to be empowered appropriately, obviously. You just don't want to be throwing money away. It's got to be the right projects with the right overseeing. But for me, it's all down to the micro, and it's very, very hard for the large institutions to think other than like, let's big dams or something like that.
Well, I see a question's come in from Louise Brown in Namibia that's exactly on this point, and she's addressed it to Luke. She asks if international institutions are not well equipped to enable bottom-up solutions, but we know the solutions that need scaling up come from the grassroots, how then do we encourage international institutions to step back and give space to local actors and institutions to step up? And how do we get international donors to channel funds to grassroots solutions instead of to ill-equipped international institutions? So a challenging question there. Thank you. Luke, do you have it on a way forward on that?
Well, not all, though I do support the idea of peaceful explosion of the system that is dysfunctional, not all is not working. That what we need to ensure is that national government, who are the one in charge of ensuring that subnational mechanisms are conducive for bottom-up approaches, are the one we must make sure that global institutions will support in doing that. And also the changes that we need for moving in that direction are precisely a kind of change in system thinking. Because you remember the quite well-known quote from Mahatma Gandhi, where he says, what you do for me without to me, you end up doing it against me. So the point here is, if it is for me, it must be with me. And if it's not with me, then it's not for me. Mm-hmm. So it is interesting to meet at the global level and set global goals and help national government to translate them into national goals and mainstream them. But we can't stop there. The mechanisms that are needed, including financial mechanisms, that could also help. For instance, when you think about adaptation to climate shocks, why is it that the Green Climate Fund is still so slow to consider mechanisms at the local level and funding mechanisms to channel resources at the local level, where we know that adaptation is needed and must be and will certainly be much more impactful if it is undertaken? So the system is still, and at global meeting, you barely see a real seat, a real decision-making seat for local players. It is government out there. I remember in Paris 2015, during the negotiation, a government were unwilling to give a seat to local players in the negotiation, because they understand is that this is a place for government to negotiate. You must change all of that. Even the UN system has been built for government to interact from 1945. This must change nowadays. We need a system that will really unleash the potential of both the private sector, the local actors, in a way that they will bring around the table not only their thinking, their knowledge, but their abilities, and therefore convert into delivering the future we want. Mm. I don't know if Louise from Namibia will agree, but that's what I have to share.
Thank you. Antje, I wonder if you have reflections arising from what Luke and Steve have both been sharing, and particularly on this on these questions of local solutions.
I think that both of them, of course, point to the sore point, because and I see it from where I sit in Brussels at the moment, is that we have very ambitious, sophisticated policy frameworks that are available. But a considerable chunk of money, as I have mentioned before, which is almost around 30 billion euros just for environmental upgrading, so to say, or climate resistant development. And the challenge is, how you make it trickle down effectively. Both colleagues said this. how to entrust, you know, and provide resources, which are maybe not only financial, but are maybe also political in enabling these actors to create their locally livelihood and, you know, peaceful communities. And one of the challenges, I mean, obviously that we deal with, and I see that also in the chat, is that we have the endemic problems of in countries like the DRC or Afghanistan in, insecurity, where insecurity or the perception of insecurity takes over everything. On also the issue of corruption, I mentioned this maybe already. And then the third one is the whole challenge of inclusivity. Governments have a challenge to really create fully inclusive approaches to environmental peace building, because, you know, it is technically not possible to include all of the actors. So we need to find new and novel ways of including them. That means includes tribal communities, but also rebel groups, belligerent actors. I mean, it sounds a little bit revolutionary, but I think unless we create these inclusive approaches, we will be challenged to not to be able to find sustainable solutions. But the second thing that I also wanted to mention is that we talk about local actors, and we, you know, maybe this community here understands the importance of local actors. However, it cannot happen without a strong connection as well to the region and the nation or the state, obviously. And there where we have a role at the international community to play is to create a sense of conditionality it sounds a little bit imposing, but I think that if we accept that this is a global threat to our security, it seems to be justified that the international community would make political and economic assistance conditional upon, you know, this empowering local communities to build, you know, land, their environmental peace as well, and development. So that's one thing. Then the other thing I just wanted to, as a last point, is that the stories and the way of how that work is not really fully understood. So what we need to do, and what CORE needs to do maybe, is being able to build the stories that can be understood by the policymakers in order for them to initiate that change. Running, for example, trust funds for in local communities, extremely expensive, extremely difficult. We have a lot of bureaucratic requirements. I mean, there, you know, I think there's still a lot of work to be done in order to be more embracing in that sense.
Antje, can you expand on that? When you say that it would be helpful for policymakers to understand stories and narratives that Co could play a role in that. I mean, if you were to step back and envision how that could happen, or what a bit more on the benefit of what that would be, could you share a bit?
Yeah, well, you're challenging me, but you know, I mean, I almost would like to say bring a little bit of Core to some of these multilateral organizations like the UN or in the EU, is that, you know, where we get to meet people who live the challenge on an everyday basis and could really share indigenous solutions to the problem. I think we like that and we love it. We just don't know how to, you know, what it is, what makes the change. And actually this might be something of much value to the global community. You know, who knows whether the farmer in Bolivia has, you know, a solution that another farmer in the DRC could use on land sharing or community farming, who knows? So I think that we need to get much smarter in bringing, you know, also creating even audiovisual stories that can be shared on a much broader level, so we can understand how this works, because we are those human beings who now operate on that we need to know before we get to act, you know, if we don't do this intuitively anymore.
Mm. Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And I can see there have been questions kind of relating to that, which we can all reflect further on. I'd like to bring in the question of the private sector and companies. There's a question from Mira Shah directed to Steve. Can you see it there? What role is there for large companies in delivering sustainable peace? Would it work to make the triple bottom line a quadruple bottom line, in which a contribution to peace is also measured and included? But on the flip side, if we simply broaden the number of bottom lines, do we end up with companies doing many things badly as opposed to a few things well? So, Steve.
Yeah, look, I'll pick up a little bit on some of Angie's comments, because I think you touched on something which is really important. And so obviously the role of the international community is really important in all this. And so if we went along to some of the most stressed areas of the world, and they're sort of in the Sahel, the Horn of Africa. So we've got to look at the five countries with the largest increases in terrorism in 2019, all in that region, all Islamic groups too. So sort of rule of law, okay, and getting the violence under control, you've got no way of being able to tackle the sustainability problems unless you've got really basic rule of law. And I don't mean sophisticated, but just basic. And so the international community can go a long way in that. Corruption, which Angie touched on too, and this lead in to the question which we've been asked, is incredibly important, because a lot of these countries are corrupt at the core, like in ways, unless you've actually spent a lot of time there, you don't really understand. But one of my experiences is the closer you get to the local community, okay, and if it's in the community self-interest, they'll regulate it. So the corruption really lessens right away. It's the further you move up, more you've got the corruption. So most people are pretty intelligent about their own self-interest. And so if you've got a community and you get the right simple governance structures, and the project is for the community, they'll make it work and they'll source the corruption. So now if we come back, we look at now a large companies. So I don't think the solution's in the large companies. I think the solution's in the micro, is in small micro industries, and some of them will grow large. The whole thing about sort of the large companies, and large companies do a lot of good things really, really well. And so that's fine. But if you're going to bring a large company in, you're going to give them control of the agricultural land. Sure, they'll be able to generate a great export business. So you've now got to revenue through taxation going to the government, but in a corrupt environment, that doesn't get back to the people, does it? Your best way is to stimulate very small businesses within these places which are most impacted. So I think the business is key, but how do you create the micro ones? Then the great entrepreneurs will grow them into big ones. They always do. So I won't go into it now, but I've got some stunning stories of people who've sort of grown up on the streets in Nairobi and ended up employing thousands of people simply because they have these great entrepreneurial skills. So if we think also about the wasted talent in these places, okay, wasted talent. And so if you can get back and you can stimulate it at a micro level, the talent will just come through, and it's not education. Like, education's part of it, but certainly from our own work, what we've found is if you just increase the education and you increase the business environment, it's slightly more likely to lead to violence, okay? You need to focus at these things systemically. You train up a whole lot of people to expect that they're going to have jobs where they're not going to get their hands dirty, and now they can't get jobs, okay, that's the fodder for discontent. And you've got worse than that, you've got intelligent discontent who know how to organise. And so if it's just business, okay, just the two of them together, you miss concepts of equitable distribution of resources, whole range of other things too. So the secret for me is not so much the large companies, it's how do you actually stimulate it at a micro level.
I don't know.
So just one last thing. It's a bit like considering sort of a swarming, okay? So if you look at a bunch of bees swarming, highly organized, okay? Or birds flying, highly organized. None of them have got any set pattern. They're just all sort of in motion doing the same thing. And sort of look at businesses, just the concept of the profit motive, the motive to sort of get income for your family and those kind of things. It works as a swarm. So many small things working in unison produce the best outcomes rather than you bring in a couple of large companies, which then have got monopoly pricing powers and you work with the government to control wages.
Well, I'm getting, I'm maybe getting overexcited by this sense that a swarm could develop and a systems approach which links policymakers with local solutions can translate itself into an ecological security system that Antje was calling for, and the global order will, the march of history will take us towards that. Could we actually be talking about something, if we aggregate everything that you've said, something actually quite positive? We could actually, keep going.
So is that a question, Alan?
That's a question, yeah. I think a question in a way to for all of you to sum up our discussion today. Mm.
No, look, my sense is that you've got to be realistic, but if you're not positive, you'd never go anywhere. Like quite often sort of when I'm doing talks about entrepreneurship and stuff like that, I always compare a new idea to a bit like a baby. Needs a lot of nurturing before you start to knock it around to see how resilient it is. And the companies and ideas are like that. You need to nurture and build them and then to determine how resilient they are. It's very, very easy to destroy a good concept before it's actually had its first breath. And so I think as we're talking through this stuff, like there's some great ideas here, we've got to be positive. And look, the change doesn't come from any one person. It comes from a multitude of people. And that's back to Leo Tolstoy's March of History. And there wasn't a great man who shaped history. The great men actually just jumped on the current of history. And that's all of us. We're all shaping history.
So, Luke.
Well, thank you. There are a few things that have been said, and I would like to reflect on them, if I may. I very much like what Antje has said regarding bringing a little bit of coal into the international or global community way of interacting. I really second that. Because one of the things that Caux helps to do, I think at least two of them I have experienced there, is trust building in a way that helps those who potentially or are already opponent or even in conflict to think of the potential of a win-win solution. So taking them out of their comfort zone to dare to think of the other side and then see eventually how they could win together. That one, we don't see it in global meeting. Global meeting are just like, it's you against me and my country and things, stuff like that. The other thing is the silo thinking. That doesn't help to think potential. And in Caux, the environment, helps you really to think about potential, your potential, the other side's potential, and eventually when you think potential, with the potential that your shared environment does offer. You will see common ground. So bringing a little bit of coal, Antje, I really hope that in your role and responsibility, you will help, you know, this to happen. And whatever I would be, I would be always be supportive about that. Another thing I saw in the chat box, a question about Africa and the regional economic communities. Let me give you an example here. You remember, and Steve has alluded to it, in the southeast of Niger, there have been a movement for natural regeneration farm. It has prospered for more than 5, even 8 million of land degraded that has been restored. That was just in the southeast of Niger, on the north of the border of Nigeria. But in south of that area where natural regeneration has been actually flourishing, degradation has worsened. The people living on the two sides of that area are the same, they speak the same language. But the reality and the lessons learned and the evidence of what is happening in southeast of Niger has not really impacted, you know, what could have actually helped to lessen conflict in the north of Nigeria. And what has happened? Degradation has built the ground for, you know, conflict and radical Islamists. And at the end of the day, those radical Islamists from north of Nigeria now has spilled over the area of southeast Niger. So we must understand that it won't happen unless we really make communities to work together and think beyond the boundaries of our countries and think us and nature and how we can end up dancing tango with nature might be what we could all commit to do. How about you?
Thank you so much. Coming back to you, Antje, on this.
Well, it's difficult to top what Lucas just said. Obviously, I fully agree with him. And I mean, I just wanted to say that maybe something that helps us to conclude this in a way is that, I mean, when two points. Obviously, when we say we need to work with the local communities, whatever local communities it is, because it, you know, they sometimes think they're the center of the world rather than, you know, the other way around. It is also, you know, as Lucas said, the importance of really people starting to be able to see beyond their sort of village boundaries, of course, and that is a real challenge because, you know, it is a very, you know, restricted reality in a place where poverty and security often are the most important, you know, factors in the lives of people. So it's we cannot be just complacent about this and making that recommendation. I think there's much more that we need to do and in a very interdisciplinary way, you know, so it really works hand in hand with other, you know, development factors, as Lucas said. So that's just the one thing. Then the other thing is that obviously we need to also strengthen and empower regional organization. There was a question about the AU and regional organizations on this. We need to really empower them to do this type of work. It doesn't belong just to one organization. It must be mainstream across all multilateral organizations across the globe as one of the main and most important priority strands of work. And then the other thing, which is maybe something that's really related to Caux, is that you know, we're working with the youth, and you know, that is the next generation who is going to have basically carry the burden of what we have, what also we are part of responsibly have created, and hopefully maybe positive things come out of it. But you know, if you have this as a calling, you know, that and a lot of young people and us, we, you know, how can it not be a calling that we want to protect our own globe? And we have this deep sort of conviction and yearning. So we need to be able to both produce the hard evidence to, in a way, to empower and allow this yearning to be followed, but also to allow, you know, different types of actors to do what they can do and not dismiss, you know, even the smallest action, because that is also sometimes a tendency that sometimes you say, that's not enough, that won't do the job. I think every effort can do something and can make a difference. And I think it will be really important to allow and empower this. I think the resources, the global financial resources are available for allowing this to happen, even if there is duplication. And I'm not afraid of duplication because maybe sometimes it will make a difference in itself. So I encourage Caux to continue to help people find their calling like that and to be able to realize this and build, you know, a more peaceful world like this with a, within an ecosystem that is balanced. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. I mean, I find myself so much more encouraged actually now than I was at the start of this meeting. And the thought that's coming to me, the word is potential, and you know that there is potential, that you all feel that there is potential, that there's a source of encouragement. I know that and I've done that. Luke has done this twice with me now. He says, how are you? And I say, oh, not bad. And even today he said, ça va? And I said, ça va. He said, say ça va bien. Because it feels heavy. Lots of things feel heavy. So I'm, in a way, I'm surprised by the feel of this meeting. So your final words then for us all on how would you encourage us to keep the potential, keep going, keep the vocation, have a sense of confidence that that it's worth doing. So as it comes to whichever one of you feels to speak first.
All right, I just thought I'd hang there and just see how long we could sit in silence, actually. Mm-hmm. Look, I don't think there's any choice but to give it our best go. Otherwise, we end up with a sustainable planet and we'll just see the potential of the human beings just slowly wither away. It won't be a fast to fall, I don't think. It'll be slow. But these things have tipping points. When they're past a tipping point, they go very, very quickly. So I think we haven't got any option, okay, other than to sort of really keep going. But look, I think there are tons of positive things out there. Look, I think the innovation of business in climate change, I think it'll get there. I think the momentum's already there, and the inventions which are coming out, just the improvement in sort of battery technology, improvement in solar panels, that's all just going to keep fueling, and it'll just end up so ridiculously economically efficient to go with clean power than to go with the dirty power. It's the way of the future. Electric cars, that's a done deal. We've now got a decade, it's longer than that, 15 years, where there's hardly been any research put into petrol cars. It's all going into electric. But I also think sort of the internet, sort of the comments which Luke were making up around the with Niger and Nigeria, we really do have to solve the issues of security in those regions. It's really imperative internationally. So one of the things we've found with our research, there's a vicious cycle around ecological degradation and conflict. And so you get the ecological degradation, and that what happens then is now people start to fight over less resources. Okay, now as they fight over the resources, they degrade the resources even further, which increases the desire and propensity to fight over the more limited resources. So to break that cycle at the very beginning, you need security. But I'll just come back and make a little bit of a challenge. I did, these numbers won't be quite right, Andrew, but I just whacked them out on a piece of paper. So we're looking at sort of the revenue, of the government revenue of the EU, or the governments, okay? I think it's about $6 trillion, roughly something like that, per annum, okay? We look at the $60 billion, which has been put aside for climate change. I don't know how many years it's over, well, probably five, okay? That comes down to 0.2% of the budget of all the money which the EU governments make, and that's... sounds good when it's 60 billion, but it's a drop in the ocean. It's a drop in the ocean to what we really need to change it. And so there's the ability, and there's a whole lot of other money which I know is getting spent, which gets spent out of local governments and stuff like that. But in many ways, we need to step up to the plate. And I guess for a lot of us too, with governments, we get a bit cynical because you get a disaster somewhere in the world and the government's pledged so much money for humanitarian aid, and you turn up 5 years later, generally you've got about 40, maybe 50% of the money's actually given. So in some ways, I think there's got to be a better accountability. And I think the other thing too, and this is something we can all get involved in because it's mainly a Western audience, I think, certainly it's in Geneva, we've got to start looking at our own governance, the way our own institutions are working. So within positive peace, there's three areas: attitudes, institutions, and structures. If we look at Western Europe, and we look at the attitudes, they're on the decrease, like faith in democracy, perceptions of corruption, the fighting amongst the elites, group grievances, just to name some. So I think in many ways, one of the best things we can do is look locally to make change.
Thank you very much. I'd like to go to Antje before Luke, who started us off on this co-dialogue with environment and security, gives us a final word. So Antje?
Yeah, Alan, I said basically what I had to say. Maybe, you know, just from where I'm sitting, from the European Union, I'd like us to see and maybe explore together with Caux, also to see about how we can create those linkages that Steve was just saying about, so to bring, you know, the local needs to, you know, a much stronger sort of policy awareness, and maybe also through our work and partnerships with the UN, obviously, which has its own connections, but, you know, strengthen, you know, that dialogue on that issue, and as well with the African Union and ASEAN. So, I mean, this is just sort of a commitment from my side to consider that and to look at that. You know, I think I've said enough.
Thank you so much. That's very encouraging. Thank you. Luke.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Steve and Antje were speaking, something has crossed my mind, and it's about the fact that environmental degradation is the main push factor of the almost forced migration. But the real thing that is forcing people to migrate is hope. The hope that they can make it out there. And I'm really astonished by the fact that hope can take a youth of sometimes even near 20 to cross the Sahara Desert and hope to even navigate the Mediterranean Sea somewhere to Europe. That hope is the hope we must tap in. That hope is the hope we must tap in and help them understand that they can invest it in their home land, their village, and because home is a driving force of an entrepreneur. So as Steve will tell you, what is driving an entrepreneur is first hope. That is that if he can make it in the vision that we have. So then for us to think about potential, we must understand, and that's what I do nowadays on a daily basis, to help youth apprehend and understand their gift and talent and how they can use them in the context of a kind of calling for them as a steward of their environment. Because if you connect your gift and talent to the potential of even your degraded environment, that's what Antje call scarcity as an opportunity, then you will act like Yakuba Sawadogo, see potential where potential seem not to be anymore. So the real resource curse in Africa, for instance, is not the one often alluded to. It is about depriving women and youth of access to the resources they need to thrive, including, of course, access to education and required enabling capacities. And we must make sure that from the global level to national level, all the way to the local level, we address that. And then you will see how the continent will flourish and how this will really also as a kind of outcome or impact reduce conflict, because the cake will have been, you know, becoming bigger and bigger. I could go on and on that. So I have been very much pleased to be part of this panel, and thank you to my co-panelists, Antje and Steve.
Thank you so much, Luke, and thank you so much, Steve and Antje. It's really been an occasion for food for thought and food for hope, I think in the best tradition.
Well, it's been a great panel. I've really enjoyed it. It's been great listening to you, Antje, great listening to you, Luke. And I think we sort of got a few challenging things in there, so, and some good comments. It's been great.
Great. Thanks so much. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Okay. Great. Thanks for bringing us all together. And thank you for the Geneva Center for Security Policy. Really great. Super. Well done.
Most welcome. Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks. Bye, everyone.